The thing I really didn't finish in Chapter 12 is some of the detailed design, the decisions I would make about what types of elements I need for holding gearing along the length of the shaft axially. And the example that I worked, I just chose snap rings for those things. So a shoulder on one side, a snap ring on the other. That may or may not be a very good design. But you'll notice I put keys underneath each of the gears in order to prevent relative motion between the shaft and the gear. How would you size the key? Well, we'll get to that. That's Chapter 11. We'll get to it a little bit later. Right now, we're going to move back and go to Chapter 7, which is belts and pulleys. And really, what we're doing, most of the elements we talk about in this class are for transmitting power. It's really the way we look at it. When we talk about chains or belts, we're talking about power transmission. Probably the hardest part of shaft design is calculating all the loads at all the locations. In fact, you'll notice we talked about chains and we talked about belts as well as gears in the context of shafts, just so we could calculate the loads that are applied to those elements that are then transferred to the shaft. Because the shaft has to support all those loads. So how do we come up with all those? How do we size those elements? Well, that's what we'll look at in this chapter for belts and, sprockets and sheaves, really. Here's our demotivational poster. Genius is 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration, which is why engineers sometimes smell really bad. So if you forget your deodorant, you could just claim to be an engineer and be okay, I guess. Belts and chains. I've designed a little bit with belts and, well, have I done anything with chains? The home stuff. But I don't think I've actually sized a chain drive in my practice. I have sized several belt drives. Most of the belt drives I used were so-called synchronous belts. Now, of course, we've all probably changed plenty of V-belts, right? So you know what those are. But there's many different types of belts. And this is a machine from Professor Dew's experience. I assume he probably designed this. You'll notice that we've got two motors, one facing each direction. We've got some belts. It's hard to tell. I'm not sure if these are individual belts. I think they are, or maybe, yeah, they must be because the printing is separate. So these are multiple V belts to transmit power from one motor to one shaft. And if you look at the other side, you'll notice that motor also has belts for transmitting power to its output shaft. Now you notice there's a difference in the size of the pulleys. The driving pulley is smaller than the driven, so there's some reduction in speed. So increase in torque here. And typically, belts operate at relatively high speeds, especially relative to things like chains. So the way that you transmit power with a belt is by moving something fairly rapidly at relatively low force. Okay, too much force and the belt slips, so that doesn't work. Anyway, you'll notice there's another type of belt here, though. This belt drive goes to a shaft, which then has another pulley on it, but it's a synchronous belt pulley. Okay, so you've got teeth on these belts. Why do you think you might need teeth on these belts? We had V belts here, and then teeth here. Why? Well, all of the torque that comes in here goes to that other pulley, right? If you decrease the moment arm, but you hold the torque constant, what happens to the force? It has to go up, because the power has to remain constant, right? Or the torque is constant. And so if you have a lower moment arm, well, then you're going to have higher force in the belt. It makes sense that you need teeth on the belt so it doesn't slip. You put V-belts here, and they're going to slip. Whereas V-belts here, at a higher speed, a higher linear speed, will not slip. So it's pretty apparent then that, you can't really see it from this view, but it's pretty apparent that then these shafts go off and drive a couple of drive shafts. There's probably some gear reduction or something in that box that you can't see. There's some bearings. You can see lubrication lines for the bearings. But it's a pretty nice compact design where one motor drives one shaft, okay, and this goes through to the back side here. Now you might look at this and say, well, wait a second, I see the shaft coming off right here. So apparently I was wrong. Apparently there's no gearing because this motor, which is here, drives a pulley, which drives the shaft. But then they put he designed it to bring the shaft through anyway and put another synchronous pulley here to connect to this point. Why do you think that both of these connect to this point? well, actually there would be gears inside here to keep the timing the same, because there are weights on these shafts. These weights basically are offset masses that sling around and shake these containers, because you put parts into them, and I don't know the details, but basically they're shaking parts around to probably clean off something or make them smooth or whatever purpose. But there's a lot of parts that goes in. In fact, Professor Deuce told me a little bit about his experience in this. He said these machines require so much power, not this one, of course, these are relatively small motors, but some of these machines require so much power just to start that they would pull a tractor-trailer power generating station next to the building to start them. Okay, that's how much power they require, which is quite a bit of power. I've never designed anything that big myself. Most of my design is a smaller scale. He said sometimes that the companies that were buying these things wouldn't listen when they said, you know, these things move a lot. They're mounted on springs, but they still move a lot, and they will transmit vibration throughout the building. So you need a concrete pad that's very thick. And people building these buildings to house these machines would say, let's not listen to him. Let's just do whatever we want. And sure enough, they shook the building because there just wasn't enough mass to absorb all of that force or that changing oscillation. So anyway, it's interesting to note that even though the output is here, in order to maintain synchronization between the offset weights, the shafts were run to where they connect in a gearbox and stay together in time. Right? But we note two different types of belts here in these photos, one V-belt and one synchronous belt. Here's another machine with a similar design. However, you'll notice there are fewer belts, V-belts here. And you can see it mounted in place next to the machine. Here's another belt in use. This is an interesting one. You've probably never seen a synchronous belt like this. This is a synchronous belt that not only has teeth on one side, but teeth on the other side. And the reason for this is that, think about the direction of rotation. If the belt goes around this way and turns, the two wheels will turn the same direction. But if it wraps around this way, they'll turn in the opposite direction, you see. And so this is a way to keep these two shafts in time with each other, because it is a timing belt. And also transmit higher force, because it won't slip. You've got teeth. Well, you can make a synchronous belt slip. That is true, but it takes quite a bit to do it. And if you got it properly tensioned, you don't overload the belt, it won't slip. Anyone know what these two things are? These are special hubs. What are they?
Taper lock.
They're taper lock hubs. That's right. Well, you'll see more about taper lock hubs a little bit later. But basically, these are hubs that go onto. Now, what's interesting to me. I may be wrong, because I actually see a key right here in the photo and one right there. It may not be, but they look like a taper lock hub because they're so large. I don't see a split in it, so actually, you know what? I bet they're not. I bet they're just a hub that's keyed to the shaft. Maybe I'll have to ask them about it. There may be some taper on it or something. I don't know.
I've seen them keyed before.
I'm sorry?
I've seen taper locks keyed before.
You have? Yeah, but without a split? Because they have to collapse, right? And I don't see any split line on that hub.
That's the outer piece that's pulling the taper onto the split hub. Because there's the split hub goes behind it.
I don't think so, because there would be a taper in the pulley itself, right? And what happens is that taper gets driven in. That the hub is what interfaces the wheel to the shaft, and this is certainly touching the shaft, right? So I'll ask Professor Hughes about it and try to let you guys know, but I don't think these are tapers, but they may be. Anyway, we'll talk about that later, and we'll see why I think that may not be a taper lock. So we've got more pulleys here. I'm not sure where power comes in. Probably neither one of these. Probably the offset weights are in here, and power probably comes in through that shaft. My guess is this is just an idler as well. I don't think there's a shaft point there. There's probably bearings in here, and that may be a dead shaft. I can't tell. And of course, I didn't design this particular machine, so I don't know. But anyway, so you can see how this works. Here's some interesting things. Look at the wrap angle around this pulley. See how there's a more than 180 degree wrap angle? This one's not going to slip. If you have any slippage problems, it's going to be that one, because look, the wrap angle is fairly shallow here. So is there a way to improve that design? Well, what about pulling this point down here farther? That could improve it quite a bit. You wouldn't have to sacrifice this. That idler is there, it's necessary, but you could use it more effectively by coming around a little bit. They may not have had the room, they may not have needed it, right? It doesn't matter too much. This may be an excessive wrap angle, it's unnecessary. Here's another case of where you can see the two weights, you can see the bearings themselves. I think we had a picture of something like this before in bearings. You can see the motor mounted to actually drive the two weights here. I'm not sure how this one's supposed to work, because if you think about it, both weights are rotating the same direction. It seems like you need them to rotate in opposite directions. If they rotate in the same direction, you're going to end up with shaking forces left and right, and I think up and down, if I'm thinking right. So I'm not sure how this is supposed to work, but at least we see another example of a synchronous belt in action. And of course, you've already seen this picture, but there were V-belts associated with it, right? A chain here. So this is relevant to this chapter. And we still don't want to ride that thing.
Still unbearable.
It's still unbearable. There's got to be a belt or sprocket joke in there somewhere in chain. Now this is, anybody have any idea what this might be? What might this be useful for? What are we doing here? You notice that this point can slide back and forth. It's really important that belts be tensioned properly. And so what's going on here is you can adjust these clamps, basically pulling on this point and tension the belt. So this is probably some type of test set up for running belts, or I don't know where Professor Hughes got this photo, but anyway, the tension in the belt is something that we always have to consider. It's something that's very important.
It looks like they're trying to figure out how much amp draw per tension.
That may be. Maybe that's what they're doing.
I don't know if they're looking at the draw, they're pulling up.
Now, why would the amp draw change as you tension it?
More load on the motor.
Is it really more load on the motor? There's more load on the bearing in the motor, that's true. So there's more load over here on the bearing and more load over here on the bearing, but I don't think that tensioning the belt would really make it harder to bend the belt around the pulley. And that's the only thing that would make more load on the motor. Because if you think about it, if this point, now this may be a brake of some type, I don't know, but if it's not, if this is just freewheeling, then there's basically no power required here, because all you're doing is overcoming whatever bearing friction is. There is one more thing that requires power. Have you ever taken a V-belt and tried to bend it? It's not very easy to bend, right? And so the motor has to actually take the belt and bend it around the pulley. That requires work. That's force times distance. It's bending. Just like when you roll your tire over the ground and you get a contact patch, you've got to deform the tire, and we call that rolling resistance, right? There's some amount of power required to just deform the four tires that holds your car up. Back the other day, I checked the pressure in my tires. My back right was at 15 PSI. What does that mean? That means I had a nice big contact patch, and I was also wasting a lot of energy. Well, maybe not a lot, but some. And so I pumped up my tires and got them to the right amount so that I would hopefully minimize rolling resistance, or the amount of deflection of the tires that comes around. Now, if you think about what's going on here, well, it's in the slides. I'll get to it. I don't want to get ahead of myself. Here's some of the manufacturers that are well known for belts, for making belts. Gates is a big name. Emerson, Goodyear, Rexnord. All these are industrial names. You'll become familiar with that. Just included them so you know that they exist. But they make all sorts of different rubber belts. Now, we need to make sure the terminology is clear. We can call this a pulley or a sheath. That's fine. Either one is okay. Pulley or sheath. Even if it's a synchronous belt, we don't call it a sprocket. We call it a pulley or a sheath. Okay? This is not a gear. Okay? Please don't call this a gear. This is a sprocket. Okay? So with chains, you use sprockets. With belts, you use sheaves and pulleys. Now, often we use these in speed reduction. You've already seen examples of that so far. And one thing nice about this is that you can get various size pulleys that are standard size, or various size sprockets that are standard size, and you can tailor the speed of the output to whatever you want. In other words, when you buy a motor, and we'll learn about motors a little bit later, but when you buy a motor, they run at a standard speed. Most of the time we use AC induction motors in the industry. That's just the most common for, you know, rough machinery. If you're talking about a robot or something a little finer, you're probably using a different type, maybe a brushless or a regular DC motor, but in most, you know, processes like you just saw, that would be those two that we saw at the beginning slide. Those would be industrial three-phase motors. Okay? They run on AC. Now, they run at a certain speed, and that speed is dependent on the frequency of the current coming into them. And in this country, that's 60 hertz. So basically, motors run at a standard speed. Now, depending on how they're loaded, they might slow down a little bit or speed up. If they're a synchronous motor, they won't slow down. There's some detail there, too. But basically, there's a fairly small range of speeds that you can get, and your machine probably doesn't need to run at that speed. So we can use this fact that we can have speed reduction very easily in order to tailor the output speed. Now, in order to quantify that and do something reasonable with it, we have to define a speed ratio. So we're going to define our speed ratio as the drive speed over the driven speed. You can calculate it as the driven diameter over the drive diameter. So let's think. If you have a speed reduction, will the speed ratio be more than or less than 1? Let's think through this. The drive speed, that's the motor, right, is going faster than the driven speed, the output machine, in the case of speed reduction. So a speed ratio greater than 1 is a reduction. A speed ratio less than 1 is an increase in speed. And you can calculate it. Notice there's this inverse relationship, drive opposite each other and driven opposite each other. So be careful about that, because if you memorize this, you might be tempted to take drive diameter over driven diameter, but it's the other way around. Okay. Belt velocity, on the other hand, is something that's also very important. When a belt is going around a pulley, if you think about it, there's some segment where the belt's just moving straight, right? So the belt straight line velocity, or the pitch velocity, is something that's very important. And you can calculate that based on the angular speed of an element and the diameter of the pulley or the sheath. Now, it turns out that there's a certain speed range that you want V-belts, for example, to operate in, and same thing with synchronous belts and so on. But this relates the linear speed of the belt. Think of standing on a V-belt. Okay, think of holding onto a V-belt for dear life if you're above, okay? And as you whip around the pulley, you get to the section where you're just moving straight, right? That velocity you experience is what we're talking about here. This is the angular speed of the pulley you just went around. It was the oddest thing the other day. I saw a ladybug on my windshield. It's February. Usually you see those little orange stinky things, you know? Did you know those actually bite? They do. I couldn't believe it. Whereas, and I think that ladybugs can bite too. But I didn't know that until my house was infested with those darn orange things. Apparently, I think they were, I read about it, if I remember right, they were introduced to this country because the ladybug population was declining. And then, of course, there's side effects. Anyway, so back to belts. So if the belt speed is too high, you can cause all kinds of problems. So too high, how do we define that? About 6,500 feet per minute or so for V-belts is too high a speed. So there's all kinds of things that can happen. There's some vibration problems that can happen. There's whipping. There's problems with centrifugal forces, because if you think about a segment of the belt as it's moving along, that's just fine, right? There's no problem. But when it comes around the pulley, you have to accelerate that section of the belt towards the center of curvature, right? Those of you that have had dynamics with me understand this. It's kind of like when you're driving your car around a curve, the car has to be accelerated laterally, right? And so that segment of belt, if you think about it, what is it that makes that segment of belt actually touch the pulley? If the pulley's like this, my hand's the pulley, and then the segment of belt is here, what makes it accelerate around the corner? Well, it's just tension in the belt, right? That's the only thing that could accelerate the segment of belt. Well, if it's flipping around the pulley, if it's running around the pulley too fast, what can happen is the amount of force required will actually pull the segment of belt away from, because you don't have enough tension in the belt to hold it in. And so what happens is the belt runs out of the groove somewhat, you reduce the friction and therefore the amount of power transfer capability. You can actually slip the belt in that case. So centrifugal forces are a problem when the speed is too high. Now, one way to overcome this and still have a high speed is to use relatively large pulleys, because if the pulley is relatively large, then the radius of curvature is fairly large, and so the normal acceleration is reduced in that sense. Okay, but still, it's the square of the velocity divided by the radius of curvature. Remember that from dynamics, the normal acceleration is velocity squared over radius of curvature. So you can only do so much with the pulleys to minimize this problem. Now, if you run the belt speed too low, what will happen, given a certain amount of power that must be transmitted, you get to trade off between the torque and the speed, right? The torque time to speed is, let's say, 5 horsepower that needs to be transmitted. Well, you can either run at a higher speed, lower torque, or higher torque, lower speed. Well, if you run at too low a speed, what can happen is that the torque requirement will be too high and the belt will simply slip. Okay, so you really want belts to run at a speed of about 4,000 feet per minute. That's a good starting point. Let's say you performed a design and you came up with a belt speed of 5,000 feet per minute. Is that a problem? No, it's okay. It doesn't have to be exactly. This is not the answer that's always right for all belts. This is just a rule of thumb. It's kind of where you start. That's what you want to shoot for. Okay? If you get too low, it's going to slip. If you get too high, it'll slip again, basically, or vibrate out of control. Now, there are many different types of belts. Any of you ever been to the Lanesville Farm Show? I've never been. I want to go, and I keep forgetting every time it comes. What time of year is it?
September.
Okay. I'll have to remember it so that in September I go, because I've never seen it. I'd like to. There's plenty of neat machinery to see. But it's common on older equipment that flat belts were used. Now, of course, flat belts have a lot of problems with them. One of them is they typically have a flat belt that runs a long distance, and things can get caught up like people. Can get caught up in flat belts, which is a really bad day. Right? You don't want that to happen to you. They're also prone to whipping and all kinds of vibration problems because you've got such a long length and they're moving at a decent speed. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, usually they were moving slow enough that usually it wasn't as much of an issue with the whipping. So.
Okay. Well, that's interesting. To transmit more power, you have to go faster, though, too. If you go at a slow speed, then you could have slippage, right? Now, that you're right, that's a good point. Older equipment typically didn't have as much power output as what we have today. Even the backhoe I have, was built in the 60s, so it was long after flat belts, but even it only has about 30, 35 horsepower. So that's probably when it was built. Now it's probably down to about 20 or 15 horsepower, as slow as a moving bucket. But it's better than a shovel and a wheelbarrow, so I still use it. But power in machinery has increased over time, quite a bit, in fact. Whereas today, if I were to buy a backhoe similar to the one that I have that was produced today, it would probably have about 100 horsepower or so, which would be kind of nice to have. Anyway, V-belts are kind of like flat belts, except that instead of having just a flat belt where the whole surface touches the I guess they're still called pulleys, aren't they? I don't know the terminology for flat belts. Are they still pulleys? Anybody know? I don't know. I would assume they're still pulleys. But if you think about a V-belt and the way it works, it turns out V-belts are not designed to run way down in the groove. In fact, the bottom of the V-belt is not supposed to touch the bottom land of the pulley. It's the sides that are supposed to touch. So if you think about the amount of surface area available on a V-belt, it's more similar to what you have on flat belts, right? You've got all this surface area so that you can transmit plenty of force without it slipping. Now, theoretically, the amount of contact area doesn't affect things, right? In other words, the amount of frictional force does not depend on contact area, but in the real world, F equals mu k is not quite right. There's more to it than that. But it's good for a first physics course or a first dynamics course. In fact, if you guys remind, how many of you are in dynamics? Any of you? A couple of you? Remind me, we might be able to do a lab or an extra credit assignment where we investigate friction force equals mu k and figure out if the amount of contact area actually makes much of a difference. Turns out it does a little bit, but we don't usually teach that. Anyway, so this is a regular belt, and you'll notice some interesting things. There's thread essentially embedded in the rubber that helps reinforce all the surfaces, makes it more of a composite. There's also this section, I can never remember the right name for this, but it's basically just rope, or there's many different materials you can get for this too. You can get Kevlar, you can get nylon, there's all kinds of materials that are used for reinforcing this. And what this does, if you think about it, rubber is actually flexible, right? And you don't want your belt to stretch. That's a bad thing. And so the purpose of this threading is kind of like the purpose of the steel belting in a tire. It prevents the tire, the steel belting prevents the tire from just blowing up like a balloon as you fill it with air. The purpose of this belting, or these threads, or this rope in the V-belt is to prevent the belt from stretching. And you can even get fiberglass as the material that's made from. So anyway, that's one design. There's another design here where you notice that The side walls are not reinforced with thread. The either end is, and there's of course a thread inside of here to keep the belt from stretching, but there's a cog in here. There's cutouts in the belt. Anyone want to guess as to why you might want this in some situations?
To remove dirt.
What's that?
Remove dirt and rocks and debris.
Never thought of that. That might be possible. Remove dirt and rocks and debris. I think there's another mechanical reason.
Tighter bend radius.
Tighter bend radius. If you think about it, this is like a thick beam that you're trying to bend to go around the pulley. This is a thinner beam, right? It's easier to bend, so you can actually bend it around a tighter radius and not generate too much stress in the material and it can cause failure. Okay? So my understanding is that's the main reason for that, is to make the bend radius tighter. There are, of course, synchronous belts that have teeth in them, and basically they engage with teeth in the sprocket so that they don't slip. So instead of relying on friction, which is notoriously unreliable, you rely on teeth, more of a gear or a sprocket type of design. There are also poly-ribbed belts, but you probably know these as serpentine belts in your car. And the idea is, what if we want a belt that has a lot of surface area so it doesn't slip, but it needs to be really thin. It needs to go around thin, small radius pulleys so it fits under the hood of an engine. Well, then you just basically put multiple V-belts side by side and build them all together. That's a poly-rib belt. I actually, the steering assist on my car went out the rack, basically. It has hydraulic assist, and it went out. And so it turns out that the serpentine belt on my car drives the air conditioning compressor, it drives the water pump. No, it doesn't drive the water pump. That's on the timing belt, unfortunately. It also drives the power steering pump and something else. I can't remember what else. Oh, well, the alternator, of course. What else? It's kind of nice to have so that your computer can control the system and actually run. But anyway, so it drives those three components. Well, my power steering rack sprung a leak. And so what would happen is I put in power steering fluid, make a left-hand curve, and I had no more power steering fluid. It was bad. I wouldn't say it was a leak. I would say it was more of a hemorrhage, probably a better description. Okay, so I realized, I can go down to the junkyard and buy another rack, or I can spend $400 or $500 and get a new one or a reconditioned one and put it in the car, which would be a pain. I started reading online, and everyone was saying, all these cheap racks you get online usually will wear out in a month to 6 months, maybe a year if you're lucky. And you're better off to go to the junkyard and get the OEM rack and put it in instead, and well, then winter came. So if you notice me struggling with my steering wheel, it's because I don't have power steering right now. The point of the story, though, is I can't drive my car without the alternator. I need the alternator, right? And so what I did is I noticed that the poly-rib belt, or the synchronous belt, not the synchronous belt, the serpentine belt, was a certain length. It was enough to go around the power steering pump, which happens to be, I think, on the top, if I remember right. So I thought, no problem, I'll just get a shorter belt and bypass it. And I did. It worked. It works great. Except, of course, it's hard to steer. But I guess that's another thing to prevent anyone from stealing my car, right? Not like anyone would. It's a piece of junk. Yeah.
Why'd you put a shorter belt on there?
I mean, so I could buy.
Your steering rack's gonna leak regardless, but it doesn't matter, does it?
Well, the problem is if you drive the power steering pump, one of the things that lubricates it is the steering. Okay. So I didn't want to burn up the pump. I eventually do want to fix it.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought about that option too. But I decided it was wise not to burn it up and then have that pulley lock up and then the belt fail, and then I was on the side of the road hoping for help. All right, something that is common in industry but you've probably not seen is a V-band belt. It's kind of like having multiple V-belts just side by side. Same idea but with fewer and bigger. This is more of an industrial belt. There's also double angled V-belts. Remember the synchronous belt I showed you that had teeth on both sides? That's kind of what this is like, where you can drive the back side of the belt. You can transfer power. So there's a wide variety of belt styles out there. And here's a cross-section of a V-belt in the groove of a pulley. The center of the pulley, the center line, would be down here somewhere. And you notice that it's designed so that the V-belt does not ride into the bottom of the groove. That's intentional. Typically, you want the belt to ride out a little bit. That's by design. There's really no need to have this section that's not at the proper angle contact the side of the pulley. You just want good contact on the sides. You can see the reinforcing material here. And one thing that's really important is to realize that the gear ratio depends on where you, where the, what would be called the pitch diameter is located. In other words, if I try to figure out the diameter of the pulley, is it the outside diameter or is it at the root? Well, what really matters is that it's at the pitch line. So the pitch line is the way that pulleys are specified. So if you buy a pulley that is, let's just make it up, let's say it's supposed to be an 8-inch pulley, that would be